this time around.
Yeah.
I think CDEC chose the first pick and EG just took the Iron.
Actually, I was speaking like during the game with another player, but whatever, about that Tusk instead of Darkseer. I felt like giving them Darkseer would be better than giving them Tusk because they're one of those teams, they use Tusk so effectively.
Yeah.
Like yet again, they won the game thanks to a snowball. Just give them Darkseer and remove the Tusk.
There were a few moments where I just felt that Tusk just totally changed the course of the gank, and it just has such a big impact when they are using it correctly.
I was also impressed by how Q played that Visage, because we haven't seen them run Visage a lot, and that was just a strong hero in that game.
You know, they always win around that fight, the area southwest of the Roshan pit, and Tusk is really strong there because of the ice shards. So I would also agree.
Heroes that are strong there as well, though, are Clockwork and Gyro, who get picked up by EG here. The Cog and the Calldown are super good in that area, as there are so many ramps to run up and down.
It's exactly three games in a row, same opening.
Yep. It is. And now we're going to see similar response as well by CDEC here. Obviously, Tuskar is removed. 5 seconds
remaining. Might look similar to game one and two.
What are the other options here? Wyvern. There's Wyvern, there's Dazzle.
I guess Wyvern is a pretty good counter for them to go for. But
Queen is decent too.
What did they get in game one after the last strike? I'm going to check.
It was Tusk.
No, game one. It was EOS PL. They second pick PL in game one.
All true. It was.
But do you actually want to reveal your carry?
No, I don't. I don't think.
No.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's good. I'm just, you know, trying to see what they would pick because they're not getting the Tusk. I thought that was really good.
I think PL is okay to reveal because it's gonna get banned by EG. Even when they have good heroes against PL, they will ban it. So that's an okay hero to pick and then ban out Ember. You know, you can make it easier. Well, they're actually going into the Visage here. It did work out really beautifully for them in the previous game, so going back to that, two really strong fighters in the Legendas.
Evil geniuses turn to ban.
Storm Spirit being removed as well by CDEC. No Storm for Smail again.
And this time around, I think it's quite smart for them.
I mean, I think no matter what, CDEC shouldn't risk playing against the Storm. And if it's a first or second pick Storm, then fine, you can counter it with your entire lineup. But they shouldn't risk a late Storm pickup by EG. They played well.
You can feel the frustration. I don't know if it's a frustration, but from EG in Stubborn Brood, because it was definitely a big issue for them last game. And it's one of those games where that last pick Brood, you know, it happened to a lot of us. You're like, I actually forgot about Brood, and I can't believe I forgot about Brood, because Brood is one of those heroes where if you're not ready for it, then it feels like you can't even play the game.
It doesn't even matter if it's a pub or if it's TI finals. The Brood last pick is always dirty. It's as dirty as it gets.
How do you feel like the Crystal Maiden's been working out for Evil Geniuses?
I think it's been really strong, honestly. I think they have had some good impact with it. But I don't know, it really relies heavily on predicting the enemy movement early on, which they did very well in the first game. Second game, well, they struggled a little bit, but it was harder because of the Brood mid.
I feel like it really helps them keep up in tempo. Like, you know, sometimes you have to wait just for that one hero TP back home, or, you know, mana. Someone to TP in and give you your bottle or something like that, and CM kind of eliminates all those issues, so they never get caught off guard by CDEC, who play a very fast-paced game.
Yeah. Also allows the Clockwork to really spam his rockets much more, because he's going max rocket build on Universe, and it's working out well. He gets very high CS on his offlane.
I mean, in the last game as well, we've seen like so many coordinations where they went for a gank, Clockwork was on the other lane, and he had early max out rocket flare, and it actually helped them secure kills.
Exactly.
So there was a lot of coordination there in the last game, how they used the rocket flare to maximum efficiency.
Lina removed as well from CDEC, not giving that one away to Smail, so really targeting Smail with the next bans here. Can only expect that EG should pick up his hero soon and not try to hide it like they did previously.
Who have they been picking for AUI in these games?
He played Skywrath, and he got super high farm as well. Mana Boots and Mech so early, like one of the most farmed Skywraths that I saw.
I wonder if they're going to go for like more AoE team fight. Like Skywrath is good and all, and I think it works well versus CDEC if they're worried about the laning phase. But I think the early team fight, I think, is where CDEC tends to slightly trump EG. Maybe take a book out of the, take a page from other people's book, and maybe go for AA or Sand King as their four instead.
I'd say they're going to go for the same. I mean, eventually they would change the sky, but I feel like they're going to go for the maiden again because it was really the. Oh, they get a summit here, actually. I just feel like they're going to adopt the same playstyle where they can actually fight CDEC back. Like the Brood, they just couldn't fight it because it was a Brood, but overall, I don't feel like EG were, you know, far behind in like map movement last game.
No, not in map movement, but it's just very tough because of how the Brood can both scout people and also force people to group up more. You can't go alone in your jungle. It just becomes much more cumbersome to move across the map. So I think it's smart by them to secure Sumail's hero already. Now, these bans by CDEC are kind of wasted in the next few picks, yeah. The Lina and the Storm.
I actually feel if they didn't secure it here, they would never get it, because the next pick going into CDEC, they would actually just take the hero. It's really good on their lineup. It's really good against the Gyro as well.
And Aggressive likes to play it. They run the safety in Ember a lot.
Well, they're actually running very level-dependent supports, like very greedy supports. Visage plus Lion. You'll see what EG does to it, or they're actually going to go for just some jungle greedy support of their own.
I mean, that's very reactive, right? Picking Lion, you want the Hex, you want the stun so that you can lock down the Spirit. It's the same when you play against Storm or Ember, doesn't matter. But I haven't seen a lot of really good Lion play this tournament at all. Like, it hasn't worked that well.
5 seconds. I think if you can actually get away with it, then you can actually make it work well. The issue is like most of the games where the teams pick Lion, they get punished so hard because they're off lane with pressure and just get kills easily here and there. And Lion has a very hard game from then on.
I mean, he's great in the mid game and he's great when he has his Blink Dagger. The problem with Lion is that he doesn't bring a lot of damage early on. And
the cooldown on his ultimate.
True. Early on, the cooldown on ulti is super long. And CDEC, they like to bring the fight often and early, so you don't have damage.
Yeah, this pick is also a really good reaction towards what CDEC have. They have very greedy supports. You need to do something about it. Like, a lot of teams have been reacting towards greedy supports by picking Undying, like a lane pressure right away when you see there's possibilities of punishing a weak support.
Yeah, that should be Aoi Undying, I suppose. Be nice. Could also be PvD, I guess. You don't really need a lot of items on Undying. All you need is level 7. If you reach that, you have a lot of impact.
I mean, it's 2 melee, though, versus potentially 3 ranged heroes on the safe lane. Do you really think that EG can contest it with only 2?
They can do the trick, though. They have Dire and they have Clockwork, so they can just pull their creeps into their own tower on the first creep wave. You can probably contest even on that lane.
And they did replace the Tusk by Doxer. I feel like it fits their playstyle a bit less, but it's still obviously a very good pickup. Darkseid and Leshrac, we haven't seen that combo so much, but it's not even a combo in the sense that Leshrac just runs in and Vacuum is like the best spell to have with him.
We saw some Vacuum Impale combos though, which was really nice. That was a few days ago now, but
I feel like it's a tough Ember game. I don't know, but like Visage, Lion, those supports, very strong supports versus Ember.
Hey, Sumail thrives in the tough games. He likes to be hard countered because then he knows his team fears Gyrocopter is gonna go ham. So I think he just wants his other lanes to do well. If they get items on Universe and Fear, he'll be happy.
So PL is still available for CDEC. Ember, as you guys said, might have been a counter pick to PL. They're just preventing a PL pick. So do you think they're gonna go for it? Or?
I actually think they will go for something stronger, like the last game, the co-op, because they are having Lion and Visage.
They're gonna take a midder, right? Or because it wasn't Leshrac mid again, so probably.
Yeah, maybe it will actually happen the same thing.
Yeah, and Queen does have a good time against Ember as well. It would fit nice because I think PL was strong here. I don't think it's super good with the Visage early on. It could work though.
They need a mid that scales though, right? So you're talking about what, Queen of Pain, Storm's Ban,
and I just got the stats of who picked what. So CDEC picked first pick game 1, as we said, EG picked Dire game 2, and now CDEC picked first pick again. So they're getting first pick over Dire, and we explained why it was the case. So in that game, it's CDEC that had the drafted advantage.
Yeah, we see the return of the Skywrath Mage. But that's very curious, as you say, because that means they have different focus. CDEC, they know that first pick is important for them, whereas Evil Geniuses are going towards the you play Dire the entire time, we're gonna pick Dire.
It was a gamble for game two, I felt, and that gamble didn't work, let's be honest. So I'm pretty positive EG is gonna take first pick game four, or maybe they feel like they could have won game two and they should go for the same approach.
Probably, yes. Only one pick remaining for CDEC. Taking some time thinking about this, should definitely be Aggressive's hero. We have seen him run Peel more than almost anything, I think, this tournament. And oh, the slot? That is ballsy.
It's a shiki left rack.
Iron shell slot. Very scary.
Okay, let's go back down to the arena where we'll rejoin our commentary team of Toby Wan and Sindarin.
Thank you very much. Yes, it is time to get underway for game number three. Evil Geniuses up against CDEC Gaming. We have ourselves an element of aggression, plus again a draft which looks very similar to game one until we hit the end, of course.
It's just funny for me to see how CDEC go in with a new pick every single game. And people are, a lot of people at least were expecting in the grand finals here that they were figured out, they had a clear-cut playstyle, they always went for like the same kind of picks. And yes, there's not that big variation, but they keep swapping out one every time. This time it's going to be on aggressive role. We get to see the Slark. And of course for Evil Geniuses, they're going to the Skywrath Mage again, which won the first game for them. Or he didn't single-handedly do it, but did a lot of work. PPD on Undying. Now, I just want to quickly mention, as far as this draft goes for CDEC, Slark is incredible with Iron Chill. It is one of the most fearsome heroes you can run into in the mid-game if he has a good laning stage. EG should be aware of this, and he's also a pretty good matchup against Gyro during the duration of Shadow Dance. And when it's over, maybe you can disengage. You have so much burst going into Gyro, which most melee cores actually can't do because they just get rocket barrage to death, but Slark has that that ability in Shadow Dance to actually take the fight to a Gyro in melee range. So I think CDEC have a very well-rounded draft with that last pick, and I think EG were taken completely off guard by it. That said, though, they have their own comfort picks.
Yeah, that they do. It's all about the comfort zone. Fear, another game to be played over on Gyro, while Skywrath Mage, you get a twofer now for AUI 2000. And Samel on the Ember Spirit, we had a wonderful display of his talents on that hero just a couple of days ago here on the main stage in Key Arena. And it was absolutely superb. And with an Undying, you always feel like that early game pressure is going to be strong. And it looks like that's exactly what EG are trying to achieve. They'll move Universe up to the top, Samel to the mid, so they can run an aggressive tri-lane at the start with Fear PPD as well as Aoi together. And this means that CDEC, well, it's not really going to change their lanes that much anyway. They're already planning on pushing that Lashrak into the mid and the Darkseer to the offlane.
It's going to be interesting to see. If this is a try on tri lane, it's the lane to watch. That's just how Dota works. When two tri lanes meet, there's bound to be a lot of action. And even if they're, let's say there's no action, then one team is just flat out farming the other, because else they will be looking to get an advantage via kills.
As you see, aggressive position, he's already looking for the early attack down here, putting the Observer Ward inside the lane, so you'll understand just how far EG moved down. Garter is the man doing the block on the wave, and then Darkseer is moving over, so Darkseer will remain on the bottom for the start. Sorry, it's the Slark who's now actually TPing himself up to top, so they've split their lanes up already.
Yeah, they just waited for whatever information they could get. They see the aggressive dual lane that EG were planning, and they just decide it's not worth it. I actually think they might have had a shot at it, but the Slark versus Clock matchup is good for Slark. Now, of course, he's going to get the help of Q's Visage, and looks like PPD will be rotating up with the Undying. And at the same time, Fear in that offlane with Gyro will not be finding as much as he would like. And in the previous Gyro games, we've seen Fear has been getting a lot of farm. This lane is not that easy for him to play the Gyro against. They have decent kill potential at level, especially level 3.
And Aggressive's not having the greatest start to his time. He didn't level up Pounce to start with, he leveled up Essence Shift instead. And that might have been because he realized he'd be going up against a hero like a Clockwork, so the mana's been completely burnt out of him already. And with the creep pull off to the side, he's still going to find his levels coming up shortly. That's just a contest for farm. And Fear, actually, they keep this dual lane off lane with Fear and AUI together. Try and keep XZ. Like they can't keep him away from the farm, but maybe they can at least force him away from the lane.
Yeah, you just see how much the teams are adapting. The moment the Skywrath rotates bottom, it's not a winning lane for CDEC anymore. So they just go and stack the jungle instead now with Garter on the line, and maybe he will rotate top. Like, they're constantly, both teams adjusting to solve the laning problems that they may have. And right now, I think EG are pretty happy with the lanes they've got. So Mel is doing pretty well in mid, as per usual. And again, this is not a matchup that I would give Ember any sort of edge in, but he's still winning the super early exchanges against Shiki. He's just, as far as the first few minutes in lane go, he just seems to be the better mechanical player in this matchup.
He might be having a little bit of help at the moment. AUI was able to pick up an invis room, and he's going to walk his way in towards the mid lane. He'll find Garda here, and well, terrific smoke time from CDEC as AUI's invis rune instantly triggers it, and you're not going to be carrying around dust or anything which can counter what was just done anyway.
That's the shortest duration smoke we've seen at the tournament.
Instantly cancelled.
Actually, did absolutely nothing. Well, what it did give them information. So, even though he doesn't get the gank, he knows that Skywrath is there, but they can't really use it for anything, so. Mm-hmm. Very good rotation from AUI.
In fact, he already just head down the bottom. He cancelled the clarity of the Darkseer, which is actually going to make it a little bit more difficult for Rexy to keep these Iron Shells up on the lane, because he doesn't have his Soul Ring just yet. The bottle has already been like ferried out to the mid lane, so he has to wait for the courier to get back. By that point, he should probably have the money for it. And Shiki really needed this too. Like, his creep wave is going to let him catch up to the farm, but he needs to be able to zone out Samael a lot more than what he currently is. Well, Ichi, top lane universe, Garda, trying to come around the corner. Peepity is still waiting in the tree line. CDEC have no vision of this at all, but they have to know he's around.
If they go for an aggressive play, PPD can skill either Soul Rip or Tombstone. He's holding his point for now, because he wants to see what solution he needs to go for. If they get the chance to just burst someone down in the cogs, we might see him just skill the Soul Rip, but I think the more defensive of those two abilities in a lot of cases that could arise up here would actually be the Tombstone, just to slow down CDC on their way in, and Universe can just cog and run out. Well, their gank did not work out. And Lion is going to rotate again.
And this is a lot of time without finding levels. Then again, he can't do the pull on the bot lane anyway, because the Observer is still blocking up the camps a little bit further to the right, so it's not actually on the magic push, so it's not blocking up both the camps inside the Radiant Jungle. But for now, Garda, right underneath the Dire Observer Ward. He thinks he's being stealthy by walking into the tree lines there, but Samael knows exactly what's going on. His Flame Guard will come off cooldown in a moment, and in fact, they've also rotated in AUI 2000. So by knowing this, they could try and go for a counter gank.
Yeah, if he stays there for too long, he's first blood. It's going to be very easy for EG once Samael hits level 6. He's almost there. Garda will decide against it.
He actually saw AUI walk across the lane. That's the reason why he backed up. Universe getting very close on this top lane. There's the Cog's going to drag in the Slark. Now he's looking for that pounce while PPD removing a lot of his life. He pounces up and away. The raucous little babble here from Universe. He'll get vision back on this Slark again. And you got Decay in just a moment. In fact, it's back off cooldown again. But with the support coming in from Shiki, they have to back up for some mail. It's a trip spirit down to the Visage. Evil geniuses, finally, they'll be the ones to spill the first blood. And it will be on the Visage after an interesting initiation from Universe.
Such a great play call from EG to go back there. Instead of diving onto the Slark, they realize there has to be a TP coming out from the Lesh, and then they TP their own in turn, and Ember just the more impactful hero in that engagement the way it turned out. Very, very good map movements here.
And what a great time to also rotate it in. It was still the Undying who got the last hit. So PPD was the man with the extra cash, but there's never a bad time to give money to an Undying. Even if PPD does play that fifth, more sacrificial position. And while all that was going on, like you TP out heroes, you've got Fear finding his level 6 on bot lane. So attacking into this gyro on the bot is very suicidal, because you'll be coming underneath cooldown. And the Slark's not really in a position where, like, aggressive is not finding momentum on this Slark at all, which is something he really needs.
He's not getting as much farm as he would like right now. The farm is favoring EG quite a lot, as a matter of fact. They're 1,500 gold ahead with just one kill, and that's just lane farm. There's been no towers pushed at all. So a very good start for them. And if you're CDEC, you probably look for a timing window that is Lion hitting level 6 and Slark hitting level 6. Then your heroes start really taking off and being able to gank very easily. And Lion will get a lot of experience shared here with Shiki, who of course takes the gold. He'll be rotating into mid again, as Q right now is taking experience there, and he has to be careful. Samael can solo him easily, but Lion is of course in the neighborhood to help him out should Samael fall for the bait.
And if Samael does initiate onto that other side, he's going to be in a little bit of trouble. Very difficult to bring in help for that. Observer Wards are going to finally time out the bot lane, so CDEC, they lose vision of what's happening with EG on their bot lane, for now at least. But these Iron Shells keep pushing the wave back out again, as now Somali does actually jump in. He goes over on Q with the Flame Guard up. It will be Hex, but he's not in range for the burn. Just backfired up, and then the hook's on him from Universe. He wants to finish the job. No rocket available. Somali barely able to escape. Universe with a Cox will buy himself a little bit of space here. He'll have a rocket up in a moment. Even Fear TP didn't try and have some part in that. A level 1 rocket is not enough to find that kill, and Universe knows it.
Just look at how fast the teams are reacting to
it. He's still
going to
give it a shot.
Made.
That's not enough. No, it's actually short as well. Middle lane, Somal jumping in again, can't get the searing change. The stun, the call out from Fear, trying to buy more space. Somal couldn't do any more extra damage, but it might open up enough for Fear to get this kill on Gardner's Universe. Actually, Cog forced himself down, and this will be a kill for Fear, but Universe trapped underneath the tier 1 tower. The kill will come in for Versace with a lightning damage as well from Lestrak. EG severely punished, as again CDEC bring in reinforcements, and again we're going now on top. Which is PPD getting just attacked by aggressive a little bit.
This is what does happen sometimes from EG. Somel is such a hyper-aggressive player, and if the enemy team is ready for it, a play like that is just not going to work. That was really a deep dive. Lion was still in position, and he lost his flame guard too fast. It's the price he pays. I think in this game, maybe he should have gone for a 204 build instead of a 303. Yes, you get a lot of damage on the Searing Chains, but hey, the extra 150 tank...
Universe, hookshot coming in with the Battery Assault. He's going to try and control the track. No option for a split earth, and now in comes Somail with the extra jump in, but the double stun going to keep Universe and Somail back. He wanted to slide a fist and then just get the Searing Chain, if possible, onto the retreating Visage, but unable to find the combination.
And while all of this is quietly happening, Darkseer and Skywrath are quietly farming in the bottom lane. EG want to make sure AOI gets a Mystic Flare at a reasonable timing so he can combine with the Clockwork. He also has really good combination with the Ember, of course, with a Sleight of Fist into Searing Chains. If that's level 4 for the 3-second duration, it's more than enough to find a kill on most of the Radiant heroes with the Flare. But of course, we haven't talked so much about Xeas. He has just mainly been staying in the bottom lane, and he is getting a lot of farm now as a result of all the action that's been going on elsewhere. And that could make for a fast mech for CDEC, whereas the one on EG will be a lot later, if they're getting one at all this game.
Yeah, last time we saw it be built over on the Skywrath Mage, and AUI, well, they have been giving him a lot of space in that bot lane. The same thing's been happening for the Undying, but BBD went into the Arcane Boots instead. He is a natural mech carrier, but you can't have both your supports taking most of the farm on the map.
And you have to get mana on Undying. This hero has a lot of spam potential with enough of a mana pool, and without Arcane Boots or some sort of other item to compensate for that, you just don't get enough mana out of your hero.
Where's that vision? He doesn't have it on the heroes. Now he'll actually see one, but misses the hookshot. Oh. He's actually trying to have a go at the Lestrak.
And Q destroyed the rune, right? So AUI just got the single rune this time around, the bounty rune at bottom. And classic CDEC play. They're going to rotate top. This now Darkseer is getting active. He's level 8. So they're looking to take the first tower of the game very quickly here, as EG planning on maybe finding a trade bottom combined with a gank. If they get both of these, this would be very, very good for them. And I don't think CDEC are going to expect this, although Shiki, maybe he does. He's actually playing back very defensively.
He's not sure about it. He's moving over towards PBD as well as Universe, actually going through the tree line to try and break the smoke, while in middle lane it's Q and Garda coming in. They're looking for the kill on Somel. The Spirit's up, but Somel won't have enough life to survive this. Support's coming in from Universe as well as PBD. They throw down the Tombstone and Fear. It needs to be a big call down, and it will be your catch out too. The new Black Gnome damage as well. Universe dropping very, very quickly with the lightnings and the familiar drops. It's a double kill for the Lestrak. They're looking for more. PPD removing a little bit of the life, but support's arrived in here. It's aggressive, going on Fear. It's a triple kill for the Lestrak, and PPD on the run. No stuns for the familiars, but they got some decent damage. Surging in the Sluck. He doesn't have pounce available, but there's that Iron Shot combo with the Death Bar Pact. There's a kill for the Sluck, and CDEC. Momentum is coming their way again. A sharp spike to the Golden Experience graphs.
They just knew what was happening. They got the top tier 1 for free. EG were trying to trade for bottom, but they weren't fast enough, so Fear left it. And they just know that, of course, they're going to be rotating into mid to gank Shiki, and they're very quick to respond with their own rotation from above.
Universe.
Spell usage there.
Gonna hookshot bottom lane, aggressive. Thought he was fine, but EG They at least get the consolation prize.
And now this combo being online, you're going to see more of this in this game. It's 100% certain that Universe and AUI will be grouping up more. Their ultimates, it's another thing about Clockwork Skywrath that isn't talked about so much. Their ultimates combo very well, and you catch them in place and you just blow them up. But they also have very similar cooldown, so they just very naturally will be able to gank at the same time. Yes, this bottom tower might actually fall now as well. So EG, the last fight didn't go well, but if this gank transitions into a tower as well, they ended up getting a fairly even trade at the end of the day.
Darkseer wants to surge in for the denial, and PPD doesn't want to let him have it. And he won't. Skywrath Mage will take the last hit. Meanwhile, in mid lane, it looks like Gard is coming forward. There's your Hex over on Fear with a slide of fist, with Chains not doing any work. Fear just explodes to CDEC. And Samel's forced back further.
He's not having a good game on Gyro this time around, which is a really big problem for EG. This hero doesn't play too well from behind compared to some other carries, and I want to say both Ember and Gyro dependent on a good early game. He's died twice on Ember, he's died three times on the Gyro. And you compare that to CDEC with one dead on the Shrek and one death on the Slark. They're just getting the better exchanges early on.
You're right, CDEC, they've moved around perfectly, the team fights have been going their way more, and this has resulted in the Shrek having almost 6k net worth. A lot of money coming into this, and we know the power of Lashrak when he gets farmed up. This isn't like game one. This isn't a support Lashrak. It is a core, and a quickly progressing core as well.
Ashiki is having a better game than in the last game. And in the last game, he was still very impactful, even though he had a couple of deaths that maybe could have been avoided. He still dealt so much damage and took a lot of focus for EG in the fights. And it's what CDEC are doing right, which the panelists actually talked about. The first Lashrak pick we saw at the main event was LGD giving it to VP, I think. And VP went with Lashrak together with Queen of Pain, and they were like, the way you play a core Lash is that you pick it together with a strong carry so that you have a mix of physical and magical damage, and it's very
PPD.
Hard to choose to focus.
That hook shots down from Universe. The Tombstone's also going to be in the neighborhood, and there's your Skywrath Mage combo. Samel wants to come in and be careful. This guy's walking around with DD with a familiar drop. Perfect timing coming in from CDEC. The cooldown will force CDEC to move back behind their tier 2 tower.
I don't think they're done yet. Aggressive, good cogs.
Nice cogs from Universe, keeping that Slark at bay. The Familiars are still moving forward, and well, no drop down. Actually, it will be over on Fear, but PPD is still standing his ground. No more real initiation there from Evil Geniuses.
EG have the way superior vision here. CDEC are not interested in engaging uphill where their ward isn't. Their ward is here, however, so they will see Universe getting in position.
They need that slow. The Lightning's going to do the job. The Surge not bringing Lashrak in range.
This should actually tell them there is a ward. You see Universe pinging it out. There's no way that Lightning is able to hit him at nighttime. So he's pinging his location where he got hit, and they will probably try to sentry this one out.
It's too far away. AUI threw it down, but the Observe Ward's further up.
And there's a Midas for aggressive.
Dire's top tower is under EG. They come back for tier 1 tower. They don't want to let it go. Aggressive loves him, man. Not only Midas, but he's farming up all of EG's jungle right now.
Oh, he's getting their stacks, but it's going to cost them a tower. I think EG would be okay with this, even if they knew it was going on.
Just means that flash farming to catch the gyrocopter up is not really going to be there. You get some money, in fact, yeah. Aggressive gets away with it. He'll move up to the top lane, even farm that lane up. Add pressure to the tier 2 tower, and this stops EG from adding more pressure into the tier 2 tower on the bot lane, or even looking to attack in to CDEC, which they want to. They have a Dire Observer Wall that just scouted them going up, and in fact, a smoke move coming out here from CDEC. They'll see Universe farming up, but it looks like that's not their target. They want top, they want to kill into a tower.
EG are taking the right path, though. They're completely escaping this gank. I'm not sure if they did see any of it with their ward. I think they didn't. At least they didn't ping it out.
They saw them move up onto the hillside, and
yeah,
without any hero, with like the only hero you got showing in a lane is a Slark. You can put one on one together and make two, realizing it's a trap.
One on one makes a trap. Aggressive is just keeping the split push going. So this is the problem, right? You can tell EG are under pressure because they respect CDC's movements and they let them get more out of the map. Aggressive playing, farming up very far in the top lane. He's going to once again start damaging this top tower. If not himself, then at least the creeps will. And XZ is also moving in position. They have a good ward here, showing them that EG aren't there. And at the same time, EG are also showing in the dire jungle. So they might flat out just lose this tier 2 for no trade.
Oh, CDEC, they're going to back themselves up. PPD's moving up. The trade-off could be from Fear on bot. And he's trying to force the lane in to get CDEC to look down south. While Samal farms up most of the Radiant jungle, he's still a while off having that Battle Fury of his. But if they can secure the tier 2 tower, and potentially even a kill over on Garda, that'll be a nice little thing to sweeten the pot for EG. But the Familiars are coming out now from CDEC. They're having a look around. They're trying to find an opening. They just see Universe in the mid. And they're about to find Samael as well as AUI. Tower is under attack. But AUI is very happy with this, if he can get the last hits on them.
Well, this game is slowing down a little bit right now. I think it probably favors CDEC a slight bit because of the Midas advantage they have on the Slark, because their Lushrak is now getting his Bloodstone. They should be able to farm faster than EG. When it comes to pickoff potential, though, the Slark is still a very vulnerable target. If he gets caught by the Clock Skywrath, he will die from full health with no counterplay available, of course, going for the Midas instead of a little bit of tankiness, or maybe building into, say, a Mantis Stall or a BKB first, but or a Drum, even, that we've seen from Aggressive in quite a few games, especially on his PL. It looks like he is transitioning now into an Ogre Club for now. So this could be SNY, it could be early BKB. Looking at BKB, EG have very few solutions for that until super late game. Both Ember and Gyro are spread damage carries that deal a lot of damage, but not really to that single target in the Slark. And if that's the reasoning behind getting the BKB, then I could definitely agree with going it first in this game with a Midas.
Your ad looks good, but EG, as you said though, like later in the game, it's going to look better for them. For now, they're trying to get a little bit more control of the early game by smoking up, looping around, and looking for CDEC, but CDEC are always on the other side of the map when these smoke gangs happen. So Lion's got an invis rune. He's going to have a bit of a look around inside the dire jungle. Unfortunately for him, he's standing right on top of a dire sentry ward. As Samal's going to walk up, Garda going to get Syrian chained up. He wasn't really ready for this one. Finger of Death is available, but Samal, Spirit Jump forward. There's already a rocket, and the Spirit Jump will allow him to get this last little tick of damage into Garda. And there she goes. There's a Flame Guard doing the work. But the tier 2 tower still drops in favor of CDEC on the top lane.
Actually, I got 464 gold for that kill on the Ember, Samael, getting a little bit more than I thought he would. Lion is...
That brings him very close to the Battle Fury.
Yeah, he's making a lot of progress on the Ember here. And this is probably going to be one of those games where EG slow play, because their early aggression didn't really work out. They didn't get the lanes they were looking for all the time. They had to shift multiple times. They're losing both of their safe lane towers, which opens up the map a lot for especially the Slark. Now at nighttime, he's even safer because he has the 1800 night vision. No one on the Dire team does. They do have a good ward inside their own jungle, though. Maybe that could give them a pickoff, but well. They're not going to have it. Aggressive is back. Let's see. Imagining this will be Assange. We'll see. Nope. Blink Dagger. Actually, getting the mobility kills. First.
He wants kills. The casual Ogre Club for life. Ring of Aquila for a little bit of regen and stats.
I would agree with this on Slark, though. Actually, getting a mobility item first. We see, I think, like 90-95% of Slark games, you get either Blink or Shadow Blade as your first major item.
Yep.
Aggressive prefers the Blink here. And on second thought, definitely the better choice than getting BKB, but now that he got a Blink first, I don't think he should go SNY. Like, now that probably is going to come out too late for its effectiveness, and unless they get a really good fight now, in which case he might still get it.
Well, for now, they're actually looking more over to just get some wards down. It is a full team smoke up here from CDEC, and EG have to be mindful of this. If they know things are not right, they're actually pinging out saying defense to the tier 1 tower on bot lane. That's where CDEC are moving over to now. There's the double Blink Dagger combination as well. You've already got Garda walking around with a Blink Dagger on this Lion. Combining it up with the Slark's movement, they can just quickly just jump in and pop any hero they really want to try and find. Now PPD puts his own Observer Ward down, so both teams having good vision over this bot lane. And Universe hook shot in. He's able to lock in Aggressive. That Blade Mount not even helping him at all. Universe just evaporates. to the CDEC. Damage and aggressive coming in more. Blinks forward, gets the leash over on Fear. They need more damage. The Tombstone trying to help out the Finger. Not enough to kill off Fear. Gunner so low. The mech keeping him up until the sun comes in. Actually, he's undying. Gain the last bit of damage and concussive shot will slow down the Visage, and Samael going in very deep, a double steering chain moving around as EG. Samael picking up a double kill. They move in deeper as well. Q's on the run out here, the Slide of Fist, they're getting rid of at least one of the familiars, and the TP out from the Visage will be successful. There's no more stuns here for EG to use.
And that looked like it was going to be a really bad fight for EG when they lost the clockwork for pretty much nothing, but it just seems like whatever team is engaging into the other gets punished really quickly. CDEC with a follow-up engage from the Slark weren't really able to follow through, as Samael with a perfect timing on the Battle Fury. If he didn't have it for... he had it like 30 seconds before that fight broke out. If he wouldn't have had that, that could have looked really bad for EG, but a lot of spread damage being done.
It flags how important that kill on Garda was. That extra cash to have the Battle Fury for that one fight. It was a critical kill, and something which Garda really, again, couldn't have foreseen because of the Sentry Ward being there. It's a D Ward position, but that's all. Now, aggressive looks for his opening with an Invis rune, but Samael's looking really good right now. He does not want to try and get up in his face. Especially knowing he probably won't be able to pick up the kill anyway. Not if there's a defensive spirit floating around, which there is behind the Tier 1.
I should also mention the mech on AUI. I'm not sure if you did.
I have not yet.
I do believe that was in the fight as well. Yeah, it was on cooldown after the fight, so definitely helping out EG as well. We were debating whether they would be able to get a mech in time or not, at least compared to CDC, who definitely got it way earlier in the darks here, but he's managed to get a decent timing on it from AUI with only 30 CS. Having Arcane's mech at minute around 20 is still pretty damn good. Makes a big difference in these team fights with so much spread damage coming out from both teams. Mech is one of the absolutely most valuable items for its cost.
That was critical for both teams during that last engagement. Looks like they're looking for another one as well now. CDEC, well then again, hookshot. They've gone up to the top, it's aggressive. Locked in here, that Shadow Dance's not going to help him too much. Actually, it's enough to pounce him away. They cannot keep up, Evil Geniuses. That Slark is just way too fast. Really thought EG would be able to dish out a lot more damage to him before he's able to leap away.
And you see Aggressive's approach to this when he gets hookshot. It's entirely possible to pounce out of cogs with clock in there if you're facing the right direction and not catch him. But he plays it the same way every single time. He destroys the cogs instead. And being only level one, they only take two attacks from him. He runs out a little bit and then he pounces when he's created the gap. So not taking any chances here. Very, very experienced Slark play here coming out from Aggressive. Just consistently, well, I guess you could say apart from that dive at the bottom tier 1 tower when he went in and they got a bad fight out of it, he's consistently been making good decisions this game.
If he can keep it up too, and after having that BKB, be the critical player right now for CDEC.
And speaking of BKB, Fear got it. So they're going to come out at roughly the same time, Aggressive, meaning he is about, what's he ahead? About the Midas in value, a little less ahead. As the other items they have are pretty comparable. Drum is a little less expensive than Blink. They both have Aquila and a Wand.
So they could be a lot more even. I'm still seeing Samael topping the net worth board. Now he's got this Battle Fury. He's moving very efficiently through the jungle and building into Ascardi as his next major item. So Darkseer might continue to push out these lanes, but I know, for me, man, you look at it, and EG are farming in the comfort of their own Tier 2 tower areas. There's no real pressure being applied by CDEC right now, but this will all change as finally their smoke has come back off cooldown again. They don't have another one for another 12 minutes, but there's one coming out in the courier now. And they've got to make this count.
And you just know they're going to use it right away as well, right?
Yep.
There's no way they're saving this. As I'm saying that, they're saving it. Great, okay.
Caster's Curse kicks in.
Wait, they changed their mind?
No, they see him. The Observer Ward's watching. The stack being done with the Tombstone as well. They could try and contest it. But at the same time, Fear's worked through this very, very quickly.
They're holding on to it for now. It looked like they... are they changing their mind now?
It's on the line. Here we go, here we go.
Like I said, they use it right away.
I believed you the whole way, Syndra. The whole way. And then jump away. The smoke is blowing already. CDEC, this is not what they wanted from this. Samael was close enough. He just jumps back to the spirit. But they're still ready to force fights. A BKB is now up on Shiki. So if they want to try and come onto this tier 1 tower, they can do so. The Ember's not in the most terrific fighting condition ever, as he doesn't have the Scully done just yet. Aggressive, there's his movement in. They get the Hex over on Samal with the Finger of Death. Is there enough universe hook shots in? Trying to push it back into defensive spirit. Samal gets out, leaves another one. He wants to TP back and then come back to this fight at full life. Aggressive needs to pounce himself away, but this is BKB, the 10-second one triggered. And then we'll blink himself away to safety. There is a homing missile in his tail. But CDEC, there's two things in a row not really going their way. First, the initiation on Samael. Well, sorry, the first being the smoke, the second being the initiation on Samael. And with these big abilities down, EG have the confidence to go into the rush pit.
Yeah, that was such a big win for them. Fingers gone, they used two BKBs. EG didn't even use their BKB on Fear. I think this one is forfeit. If you try to fight into this as CDC now, at least you need to get a really good vacuum wall. But there's no Blink Dagger on XT. He will force staff because of the clockwork. So finding that surprise engage that we have seen from him before, Vacuum Heroes up onto the cliff, is pretty unlikely to happen here, as they will even lose and have to resummon the familiars from Q. This is a very long cooldown as well. EG finding so many wins out of one fight. And this is an Aegis.
Wow, hookshot down, they actually go even deeper. XZ burns from the Mystic Flare as well as the extra attack. They still lose the T1 tower, and Samael, huge trouble. He already pops the Aegis Immortal, but at the same time Aggressive trying to run himself out of the cooldown. Successful with that Shadow Dance. But again, these familiars, they're gonna lose both of them. That's so critical, over 2 minutes without any familiars on the deck. Visage is basically a Soul Assumption and Grave Chill right now.
And it's a level 1 Grave Chill too, so it's pretty weak. Oh, Gardner was looking for it, but Samael quick to jump out. So this is 2 minutes with CDC without familiars, which in one way is a really big problem. Or well, it actually is a really big problem because he can't farm his eggs. He would like to farm it and then use it when it's off cooldown, but realistically getting 600 gold in the next 2 minutes is not really going to happen. So if he had the familiars, he could have probably managed to get it around minute 31. Oh, he has to wait a little bit longer. And this time Q is going for a different build, so let's mention that, because last game I was talking about his mech visage with Tranquils. This time it's Tranquils into Ags, and it's simply because the Darkseer is a better mech carrier and gets it faster, as he would have more than likely gone for the same build once again. But those birds, I don't know if Ags is the real or the right item in this game, to be honest. He's playing against Flak Cannon and Sleight of Fist. He could just die really quickly. Whether you have two or three might not make the biggest of difference compared to having, say, a Solar Crest or your Slark.
I agree with you, man. It's one of these times where you think, okay, am I familiars even going to stay alive during the team fight? If you can have them alive and you got those three stunts to combine up with your vac into a big wall and the track follow-up stunts as well, then sure, it'd be terrific. But for now, EG, they have ways to counter that. As this Ember Spirit gets closer and closer towards Skadi, even if he does get familiar drops, the Ember Spirit might be able to survive the initial attack. Knowing also the fact that Universe has always been there when the initiation has started, those hook shots, really troublesome. But to then also mention, Undying put a Tombstone down during the fight. And CDEC is difficult to get a lot of space to work with. These BKBs are definitely going to help on the course, but Latrak, they really need a victory on a team fight because he's down to 7 Bloodstone charges on this Lesh.
Now that you mention Undying, Now that I think about it, I'm starting to worry a little bit for EG's game plan in super late. Yes, they have really good cores on the Gyro and the Ember, but both Skywrath and Undying really fall off. They're lane dominators, they're early mid-game oriented, and AY is trying his best to stay relevant by getting a medallion into a crest, probably. So he's going to be, in a way, more about his items, the mech and the crest, than about his spells that just get flat-out countered by BKB. This hero is like one of the absolute worst heroes in the game at playing against BKB carries. You're super fragile, you have absolutely no mobility, you have nothing that goes through BKB at all. And you can just be singled out, so it's very important for EG that both of their cores, as well as the clock, who's doing a great job, keep farming so that they can still manage, even with their supports definitely falling off later.
CDEC are trying to put down some aggressive overwards, and wow, these guys only just came back to life again. They can't afford to lose these familiars. One of them will drop. The resummon is still just under 2 minutes. Also, to keep our eyes on top lane, aggressive pushing in. So someone has to TP back, and it will be Samael. Easiest player to TP back when he can just remnant back to the lane as well. It's just easy movements for Evil Genius at the moment. In fact, it ends him with a jump from Aggressive, the hook shot from Universe. They're actually going to isolate the slug. It's BKB TP out. No way to cancel this one. With the hook shot already being used.
Yep.
So a smart move out.
But this is still good for EG. They force out another BKB charge. CDEC not really finding that much. And that is going to be a really important thing later in the game. Because that way Skywrath can be a lot more important. If these BKBs weren't even being forced out and CDEC were reaching, say, like minute 40, 45 with 10 second BKBs on their carries, that Skywrath could really have a hard time. But 5 seconds is definitely possible for him to survive, especially with all the armor he's managed to build up with this build. He has 12 bonus armor right now. Can maybe stay alive.
Universe aggressive, trying to go for the pounce on him, but the four staff allows him just to get that rune and get out. The rune being an illusion one. Where does Samel go here? Is this just that time where you go for the Daedalus?
Yeah, I think so. You rack up the damage. You know your supports aren't going to be doing that much damage, so you and Gyro have to do it. And you have to do damage to single targets too. Like, he can't just spread damage, but with the Daedalus, you hit a single target really hard if you get the right crit. In comparison to, say, a Desolator, where you just spread out stable, solid damage, but don't get off that really big hit. I think that's definitely the way to go.
CDEC again are moving into the dire jungle. You have the Aghanims now completed on the Visage, so we will have Trip Familiars.
And the Crystal is on Samael, so it is going to be a Daedalus buildup. I like the fact that he stops for the Eye of Skadi on the way. Samael is known to be a very aggressive player, and in this game he's just realized, based on the way the fights are going, he has to tank up. If he goes for the full Glass Cannon build, he's going to be targeted out and have a really bad game. So he compensates for it by getting a really solid stat item, which is also really annoying for the Radiant to deal with. They're pretty mobility-based in their fights, and just getting slowed down by the Eye of Skadi on every single target when you jump with a Sleight of Fist is problematic to deal with for heroes like Slark and Lishrak who want to keep running you down.
So CDEC now. So how do you even stop this right now? You got CDEC who are holding back. They're chilling inside the dire jungle. They're taking a little bit of farm from here and there, but nothing's really been forced. While the Ember Spirit and the Gyrocopter continue just to free farm up. The slime's getting slightly bigger, but doesn't appear to be farming anywhere near the rate of Evil Geniuses. In fact, the EG boys are getting more experience off this map than CDEC. In fact, the hook shot barely missing Shiki. That would have just put them even further behind. It just feels like CDEC are battling against the clock when EG is going to be ready to force the issue and push down the lane.
I'm really not so sure that's how it's going to play out, because they also have a Darkseer on the defense. Again, if you look at later on into the game what this lineup can provide, of course their vacuum combos are going to be difficult to land. Like vacuum into Split Earth or vacuum into Earth Spike or vacuum into Bird Stuns are all three pretty difficult, but they have three of them. So there's plenty of potential where one of their heroes is locked down and they can still get it. And Darkseer in the late game situation, you just know that wall is going to be effective. Like, if you get a copy of Gyro and a copy of Ember, those are agility carries, and the illusions will hit hard. And the stronger you get, the stronger they get. So CDEC don't only scale with their own strength, they scale with the strength of their enemy, who are definitely focusing a lot on farming those two cores, so those wall illusions will be bigger than, say, if they had spread the farm out on three or maybe even four heroes.
The only way that could really backfire is if you have that Battle Fury doing work with
yes,
those illusions.
Absolutely.
That's when you'll have some problems. But Slark can have a little bit of an easier time with those problems. There's now the full Skadi being delivered down to aggressive. So he's becoming tankier and a better hunter. But both these teams are not wanting to fight. They might be forced to in a moment though. Roshan has potential spawn time and in roughly 5 seconds. And already CDEC, they're moving around the pit. So we'll have just about a 1 minute spawn time for Roshan. That's not too long into the counter.
And there's a gem on queue. CDEC are preparing for that situation to arise. And EG with pretty much black map. They have one, which is very defensively placed around Universe's position right now. I think, do they have two? No, they have one. And a couple of sentries to go with it, but mainly looking for aggressive CDEC wards that they either countered or just were never placed. Samael is putting some pressure. There's another sentry being placed here.
Yeah, it goes scouted out by the Visage, though. He pinged it straight away. They can get rid of this, and then the jump in. They find Samael out of position. Tombstone, Soul Rose, and Melanie's more time to back into the wall! Maybe he's gonna go down! Fear trying to do as much damage as he can with the hookshot from Universe. A little bit more control time here for CDEC. They're just so tanky. Passage will at least pop inside the cogs, and that's the gem on the ground. They can move forward and grab it for themselves as Samael, in comes Lion again for the stuns, trying to combine it with the Familiars. Shiki, real trouble for him. Yulsef, the Zumpaskara cannot help him out, but he's got more help. Aggressive at the front line, but Fear pushing in after Aggressive. They split up the fight. Visage took out the Ember Spinner over with their Spirits Aggressive. He'll still go down. They're mopping up the Familiars. The last attack in from Aoi will take care of it.
And this is why Samael got a Scotty. If he did not have a tank item there, he would have been blown up and that fight would have gone horribly. But instead, he manages to disengage. The burst damage from CDEC is not enough because of a superb soul rip coming out from PPD there. And they managed to turn the fight around, which is really incredible for me, considering the vacuum wall from XC was also good, but just managed to buy enough time for the spread damage of multiple Slights of Fist and, of course, the flat cannon and call down that a lot of them tanked was enough in the end. And big fight for Evil Geniuses, even though they lose some mail there. With how that fight was initiated, I think they're going to be very satisfied with the outcome.
Especially if they can take Roshan. PPD is going to commit his ulti for this, as well as the Tombstone to help him out. Fear's got the damage for it. But they don't want to kill this off too early unless they're going to give the Aegis, and they'll have to give the Aegis the Immortal over to Fear, as Samael is still dead for another 13 seconds. CDEC won't get there in time. They don't have people anyway if they do arrive there. And it will be the Aegis Immortal and Roshan going the way of Evil Geniuses.
Even though they don't get it on Samael, it's better that they get it not just to have it on Fear, but also so it's not on the Lesh. Like, you really don't want to play against the Leshrac with an Aegis here.
Shiki would really love that too. Like, he's got 5 Bloodstone charges. He can't survive during these engagements. The Yulsep is being used defensively to try and, like, just avoid EG's attacks. But that's not going to be enough. They need to actually have that first EG hero lock down Samael. Moving forward, if he has a bit of a peek, he'll see the Darkseer. Side of Fist Serene Chain actually on XD. He tries to search away the hookshot. He was expecting the surge to just make him run, but the chains lasted a little bit too long. So the hookshot's off target.
Yeah, that's an uncharacteristic and unfortunate miss there from Universe that would have more than likely ended up in a kill.
Aggressive was going to turn it around by walking into the dire jungle. I don't know if it was really going to work, however. When you
Who
also
got the gem after the fight, by the way? Did the Radiant recover it or did they lose it?
They lost it.
Right? Or did they put in basically...
No,
where
is
it? Dire's bottom tower
is under attack. It should have been recovered.
Who has the...
It's on Courier. It's on the Courier of the Dire side.
Yep.
And so now delivered over to AUI 2000.
So EG managed to steal the gem of XC, which even furthers their victory in that team fight.
Just good times all round for EG. Dire's bottom tower. They're still, like, this game is still so even. The gold, there's not even a difference of 1,000 in it. The experience, however, is a different tale, as Evil Geniuses have about 5K on the experience going their way. And they're going to smoke up and see if they can force the issue a little bit more.
Yeah, they want to take advantage. River.
They're going to come right in the side of Aggressive Universe. Actually hugging the side so he knows there's someone. Well, actually, he doesn't know if he's on the right or the left. And Universe actually not visible at all to CDEC, but they caught a glimpse. And so the Darkseer and they're farming up that camp. You could hookshot yourself into that. But the rest of EG will have a hard time following him in.
There's multiple key items coming out on CDEC, by the way. They just got a Force Staff on the Lion. They got a BKB on the Darkseer. And they got
Shot.
The...
Oh, we got him! Mid-pounce! Aggressive, real trouble! With a Rocket Orb coming in, homing missile's gonna connect. Can't break free of the stun. The cooldown will come with a decay. He's able to at least pounce himself away to safety. But they go for more. The Slide of Fist Searing Chain catching on XE and Aggressive. He's still running himself away inside the shadow. It's the back into a four-man wall. EG will still trigger one of their BKBs. And Shiki, as she isolates on the backside, trying to TP out of the cover of a BKB. He'll be successful. In fact, a Finger of Death ensures the kill on Universe with the Spirit Jump up. Samael also wants to find his target. Got it back into the lane, Aggressive, waiting it out, he's regenerating up, ready to come in. Fear, this isn't the path to freedom right now. He's gonna get locked in. Aggressive, where's your damage? It's all there. He's stealing the essence of Fear out of him. The Aegis Immortal will trigger, but Samael's still here, but the Familiar's coming in. The Suns are back off cooldown, so they can keep Fear locked. They go back in again, the Mystic Flare Bison Smoke with the flag back in. Gata, he's burning right now, the shield of Samael. While the battle's still going on the back lines, Fear needs more help. Can't find it though, he's gonna pop. They might get these steering chains, but Samael hit the deck. deck, started fisting around. They need to bring him down. They're going to, slowing him down, and it will be enough. The fight goes the way of CDEC. PPD was trying to come back to help, but it was all too late. And what a fight. Huge advantage, and now they can force down the mid lane for the tier 2 tower.
This is the kind of fights that Slark just thrives in, when he can't get focused and locked down, but gets multiple attacks off and just steals what ends up being 60 agility in that fight with his Essence Shift, just laying into fear, forcing out the Aegis. Then whenever he drops to half health, he just disengages and re-engages really quickly, comes back with full health again. And that's the problem EG have with their draft, right? They keep spread damaging, but they don't focus aggressive down fast enough. So the longer the fight extends, the stronger this Slark gets. And if you look at that fight, that was absolutely crazy. There were so many plays in that fight. And of course, what started the whole thing was the patience of aggressive. I cannot believe he was patient enough with his BKB that he didn't go for more.
And he comes with a double damage through, chasing after Universe. The mech will be triggered right now from AUI, and aggressive going in deeper again with a BKB triggered. He's actually attacking into the tier 3 tower. Oh. But he's got blink still.
Hookshot.
It's up.
Not gonna try. So if Samael was alive, they would have gone for that, I think. Sorry. But he's the only one who can catch up, so he would have got himself into a horrible position there with Universe, but... Yeah. Yep. The Slark, as I was saying in that previous fight, super patient, uses the BKB very late, which helps a lot in the fight, and in contrast to that EG, they got forced to using their BKBs by the four-man vacuum wall, and that's what opened up the fight to Slark when he knew Fear didn't have the magic immunity.
As these BKBs start dropping in time, all this money which CDEC are picking up, like I suppose the Abyssal Blade doesn't really care that much once Slark completes that, but you managed to gain yourself almost 7,500 net worth in favor of CDEC. Even the experience kicks up by almost 10,000 as well. It's a huge swing. Evil geniuses, they may be staring down the barrel of a lost TI5 grand final, or at least this game. And CDEC, they can group up again. Are we sitting at a smoke point now? We're not. It's still just a five-man movement.
I think if you're CDEC right now, you want to slow play. You want to wait for the next Roche, or... Like, there are two ways of looking at it. Either you fight right now, so Roshan, in case you lose the fight, can't respawn yet. Or you play it slow and you look for the gank when Roshan is about to have a potential spawn. Now, knowing CDEC, they probably want to fight right now because they want to fight all the time, but they're not the only team looking to do it right now.
Yep, EG, they're going to go for the loop around, so you leave Samael on the front lines and you bring the other four from the rear.
While this could work out very well if they catch Garter first.
That Observer was still down though. The smoke might break, but you're right, Garter is a long, long way at the back. The smoke's actually going to break here for EG. Universe hookshots up with the battery assault. It should be out of control. Garter and Samael jumps further down. Universe forced up, and Garter can't do anything about it. If he turned around to attack him, the Blade Man would have just killed him anyway. The Undying Minions doing their work. So a good smoke from EG. They do find the Lion, and they fuse a very tense situation with CDEC around their bottom tower.
They do, however, not get any collateral. There's no tower they can claim, there's no Roshan yet, and I don't know if that was the timing EG was looking for. I think they just aren't happy with just finding a line. They were looking for a way bigger kill than that one, but CDEC immediately disengaging when they realize that they're kind of being pincered in with Ember from above and the four others from below. Get out with one casualty. At the very least for EG, though, it opens up the map a little bit. Yep. Get to push bottom. Maybe they do get a collateral after all. Looks like CDEC don't want to defend this tower, so... Smoke for Lion and Tower, I think, is okay.
Aggressive is coming,
if they're ready for Roche with another smoke, or if they're on cooldown for both teams.
They actually use their fortification. The Familiar's coming in close, too. Fear's in the neighborhood. And Samael doesn't want to risk himself. He's 10 gold away from completing up the Daedalus. So all he wants is just that last hit and to survive.
Yeah, they have to get the hell out of there.
They're keeping up
pushing.
Universe, where's that hookshot? He already got stunned the first time he arrived. The Rocker will give him the vision on the Lashrak, and there's your hookshot up. He's able to get himself away, pushing the Lashrak back, but where is your stun? You don't have anything to penetrate the magic immunity. And there's definitely not enough damage to kill him before the end of the PP. And now CDEC, it's smoke time again.
Big item alert here for Ember Spirit grabbing the Daedalus. There's also going to be a Force Staff now coming out for AUI, so a couple of big items for them going into this fight that could just give them the little edge they need.
Or Clockwork. Yeah, it's illusion used. And well, no, Smell not caught. The Tombstone will drop in fear, trying to battle it up. He did get actually mashed up for a moment, but Aggressive is not winning this fight. He has to pounce himself away. PB is going to stick with him, and there's your Searing Chain. Another Decay. He's going to drop in life. At the same time, a quick run out of here. You've got a Yule Scepter Orb going to keep Ember Spirit out of the fight for the moment.
Aggressive found it, EV.
Well, that's a nice little rune to have. Can come back into the fight if you can, but EG, they're trying to isolate both Q as well as Garda, who got caught the bottom river, but these familiars, they're already attacking into AUI 2000. And Fear's not sure about this either. He did a little bit of chip damage, but EG, they're just not finding that one hero out of position for CDEC.
It was so important that Sumail did not mess up the first Fire Remnant. If he didn't activate that properly and get out of there and he got caught by the Lion, that would probably have been game. He didn't have buyback, he just bought the Daedalus, and I think at this point CDC might actually have enough burst damage to bring him down. Crucial. And he stays calm here under pressure for EG. CDC are looking to advance again. They have BKBs up.
Oh, that's a jump from Aggressive. Right on top of Fear, goes for the instant bash as well. The cooldown's coming in. Fear being forced out of the way. They're trying to make it run, and actually they forced up on the outside. Shiki was trying to come in from the other side of the fight, but now they use the Mystic Flare. Well, actually on absolutely nothing. It just keeps CDC off the ramp up into the secret shop.
Yeah, Flare is gone. The Tombstone is gone. Actually, it's spawning zombies that get stuck because of the familiars. Someone eat a tango.
Free the zombies. EG. And so Tombstone's down. It's down for another 30 seconds, but CEC are in no real hurry to try and push this in just yet. There's still three waves to get back under control.
They absolutely have to get back to this pit now. Roshan's respawned. There's no doubt that EG will be looking to scout this out in a moment as Sumail claims the Ancients. They know Shiki is top, so they feel pretty confident moving around into this area. The Rocket's going to scout it. This fight is... So I think if CDC get the Aegis on the Lesh and they don't lose a fight to get it, they easily have the potential to push high ground. For EG, they need to get it just so CDC don't get it. I'm not sure EG can convert it into racks, but I'm feeling really confident for CDC that they should be able to with their current staple items on their heroes. Here we go.
This slunks the neighbor. There's still the Observer Ward on the cliffside just behind Roshan. So AUI is very visible, including Universe. His positioning is very well known.
They're taking too long.
Yep, they're not going to get here in time. This is Roshan, Aegis the Immortal, and the Sumelash is giving the cheese into his hands. It's Gyro with the Aegis and Aggressive, locked inside the pit, the back, he's got him on the wall again! But then again, Fear just turns on the damage with the call down. They're trying to escape, they have to get him off the hillside. Where are these four stars? Sumail is down, there's a four star from AUI. They're out. The Lion, the only casualty during that fight, but the rest of CDEC are trying to bail out of here.
EG taking a big risk. And it pays off. If CDEC catch them in there with a vacuum combo, they're in a lot of trouble, but EG were fast enough. I don't think CDEC expected it to go that quickly, and they missed their timing there on it. Very, very important for EG to grab this for Fear, and doesn't look like they're scared to try to push for a lane of racks here, or at least the tier 2, as, yeah, they have a lot of unclaimed power still to get. There are three towers behind CDEC.
Universe.
A lot of gold here.
Q. He doesn't really want to try and fight this one. Man, why wouldn't you want to push that? Like, you've got insurance over on the Ember Spirit, having this cheese available.
Absolutely, you take the tier 2s.
Yeah. Sure.
I think they go bottom as well. Or maybe even top and try to get both towers there.
Maybe even look for a fight as he is in trouble. He'll let the cooldown go, but there's your Abyssal Blade. It's still not going to stop Fear from pumping out a little bit more of this damage. They need the BKB to wear off so they can force arm him down the cliff, mate. But it's not going to happen. Aggressive just keeps fighting. And Garda, they've actually iced him with a double zone. So as well as PPD. X is keeping him out. The Agency model is triggered right now. But Samel, side of Vince, he's more units to actually get the bounce off. Fear, dying to familiars, Aggressive, they need more help. Mystic Flare's coming in from AUI. Aggressive still alive until the orb is chasing him up. He should be able to survive this with a blink away. He's buying time to regenerate while PPD battling up against the rest of the familiar.
Oh,
the sun
God,
comes down. The Glimmer Cape will keep him alive. AUI will regather the gem now. They can't get rid of these familiars. And Sumail, well, he doesn't really want to fight either. He does have the cheese available, but they burned the Aegis and they lost the Gyro.
These fights are so extremely close. It's absolutely incredible how no one gets just a decent lead in the fight and is able to snowball through, but all of the mobility that both teams have, the BKBs, the four staffs, the blink from Slark, They just keep kiting very well and aggressive with another great fight there, by the way. He goes in on Fear, makes sure he steals a lot of stats here and just kites around using the BKB at the latest possible moment. And of course, I'm not sure what we actually had on the camera that people were seeing there, because there was like two fights going on at once. Saw the jump on Fear in the fight there, but of course the split fight with the Darkseer as well as the Lion, and for EG, with the Skywrath Clock and the Ember. And a full duration Tombstone, by the way. Very important in this fight for EG that that does not get countered early on.
I believe we actually saw both on the camera.
Oh, okay.
The wonderful ability of Zoom.
Zoom is good.
So, EG, you keep having these close fights. See, both EG and CDEC, how do you get the upper hand? Like, what's the goal here? Because right now, for me, you look at the cores, and the cores are farming quite equally. Like, Aggressive comes in with his Abyssal Blade and Scunny. It's like, okay, well, I'll go up against the Gyrocopter. It's a fairly even battle, even with, like, Monkey King Bar and Butterfly over on Fear. Everything's just even Stevens. And then you got this Ember going up against the Lashrak, who now looks to be very close to completing up his Scythe of Vice, making him even stronger.
I think if you're CDEC, you look for another fight without the Aegis, because you've proven time and time again that you can shut down Fear in the fights with Aggressive on Slark. So if they can do that again, they'll be in a really good position. For EG, I think it's more about pushing out the waves, maybe slow playing a little bit. If they're looking to push this top tier one, they could be in a really bad position if they get cornered by the Slark here, and should maybe try to slow play and wait for the next Aegis, and playing for the really, really late game.
It's a long time, CDEC, they haven't shown that patience in this game.
Big item.
Yep, they're coming. It's the Lincoln Spear for Samael.
That changes things quite a bit.
That actually means the Scythe of Ice from Shiki is not going to be as fantastic. For CDEC, do you really want to try and defend this? They're going to use a smoke. Four heroes in it. They have to know most of EG is on this top lane, because they started running towards the mid and then they just all of a sudden did 180 and turned the other direction. But that tower on the top is almost down. The Rock scouting it out for EG. Obviously, they're not going to see anything with these smoked heroes. And Lashrak will just deny the tower, while the Familiars are the ones doing the split push. They're pushing up middle lane at the moment, but EG want these remaining towers.
We're going to get a resummon of the Familiars as well from Q, so they're actually ready to fight. I think he had one of them dead, so... wanted to... They're actually going to give... Nah, are they giving this away?
It looks like it. Oh, and again, a shot down! They're going to find Shiki! He'll BKB, but is there enough damage to get the kill? Samael can't reach him! He tried to slide a fist in, but the cogs actually kept him out. So CDEC, they know that Hookshot's going to be on cooldown for another 23 seconds. Familiars preparing to come in from the side. Fear, remember he's got that BKB. And Samael's got that Linker Sphere up and running, so the initial attack won't be as easy. And in fact, Slider Fist trying to keep him back. In comes Aggressive, triggers the BKB. PPD, Ori with the Tombstone down. He may not have enough of an opening. In fact, maybe they will. They found Aggressive locked inside the cogs while over on the side. Fear is keeping the Visage out and then the back. Trying to go over the wall. They get it perfectly. With Shiki pops over the more damage. Samael gets the Slider Fist off. He's so low on life. And now, a little bit more. They can't even get him out. There's more damage coming in with Lefrak. So low on life. Aggressive turns the fight. Going on Fear. The stuns are there. PPD back to front line, trying to remove that life away from the Slark. And they keep going. The seal is on him. He can't pounce away. They lock him inside the cogs. Aggressive is down. Huge kill. Shiki no longer hiding in the trees. It's not safe there. The Lion is back to face, and so is XT. A huge fight for EG. An invitation to force buybacks here from CDEC. If they can push into the tier 3s.
That cheese on Fear. Perfect timing using that. And CDEC will have to buy back one, if not even two heroes, if they want to hold this lane. They're buying Shiki back for now.
They don't want to have the Slark, though. And Shiki already getting concussive shot at XZ. The back will come. They look for the Sun and only connects over on Fear while Universe pushing Aggressive back. The cogs are keeping him out while the Slider Fist goes again from Samael. Defenses for a jump and they're all trying to keep me out. They got the double buybacks. That's what they're looking for. And Aggressive, Abyssal Blade is still available. Blink Dagger off cooldown. And in fact, Samael up in the air with the all set. Blink Spear will trigger, but Samael, he's gonna go down. CDEC, they get something back for their buybacks. In the meantime, middle lane, there's no tier 3 tower here. The Kriway pushed in, and is already assaulting onto the melee racks. And that also was... on bottom lane, look at that farm down there. It's heaven for a Visage. So many range creeps, he'll just soak up a lot of that.
Well, still a very expensive hold for CDEC, having to buy back their two biggest cores here.
They forced it from EG as well.
They forced one out from EG in turn, so it's not that bad, but Fear not having to buy back here in order to hold, it's going to give EG a pretty big bump in the relative strength between these two teams. And now we're down to the next Roshan. EG got so much out of the last one. The Aegis helped them win a fight. The cheese, same story, also helped them win a fight and even force out those buybacks. And if they can get the next one, CDEC, this time they simply can't let it happen. Like, they have to be there earlier. Aggressive was pinging it out last time, but the reaction from his team wasn't fast enough. I'm positive they will be fighting for this one.
This game, just when you think someone's gaining an advantage, the graph just swing almost back to zero. The gold graph actually was a very deep dive to 2500, but the experience is practically on the zero mark. Not a lot in this game at all.
Look at the gold.
It's still anyone's. It actually went down for the first time, but then it instantly spikes back up.
Actually, this game's completely dead even. Then the question is who utilizes the gold and experience better?
But that just comes down to teamfight execution. Like you can talk about buybacks and everything else. You're kind of looking at everything both teams want. That Scythe Vias, once Lashrak takes out this camp here, he'll have the money to purchase it. That means there obviously is no buyback because he already spent his money on this. But the Gyro is spending his cash. Actually, it's a smoke move from EG. They're coming up to the Radiant Ancients, and they're going to find CDEC, but not where they really want to. They need to get up.
Aggressive is starting to run away from his team.
Oh, this he could lose the Scythe. The courier's coming in with the rest of the Scythe. It's so close. Lashrak missed the hook shot in. They need that courier dead right now. It's on the run out. And actually, he doesn't even want to turn to pick up the Scythe. Now he'll turn around. Okay, that's just free gold that they're not taking. But they move up. There's your Searing Chains over on the BKBs from both. As Aggressive also jumps in, looking for the Abyssal Blade Trigger and Universe. Hook shots up. Pushes the Slark back. There's no BKB, but Shadow Dance is available. The Tombstone will split this fight up. If CDEC want to come in through the rear, but now they're running over to the dire side of the jungle, chasing in Samel right behind him. Has a Blink Dagger off cooldown. Another hookshot gonna go to work. They find their opening. It's the Lion down. Q also being thrown down by that concussive shot. Locked inside the cogs in the middle of the river. He needs a path to freedom. It just doesn't exist. It's Samel. He even goes in deeper on the back of Chicken. Some will be available. They back him back in. There's still defensive spirits available. Side of Fist. And maybe there is enough damage. Aggressive. Siri chained up. They need the damage. Forced up. Away, Aggressive, no space to live. X's in huge trouble, trying to run himself out of the cogs, forced up out of it. And this is real trouble right now for CDEC. Dicky dead in the tree line as well. There are no buybacks available. Lion, the sole survivor, the only thing that is stopping this game right now is a creep wave pushing the tier 4 tower up the tier 3 tower in the bottom lane. But that's no real problem. They'll spirit jump back out, and EG, they are coming for the mid lane.
They should be able to at least mega right now. They have a full minute on three cores on the enemy team. And what's really important about that fight for EG is the way they initiate, the way they flank. They move in from two different directions. Darkseer is never able to really find the vacuum wall. As a matter of fact, he probably holds the wall too long there and ends up getting a pretty mediocre one when the fight is over. Lion never gets a spell off, gets killed way too early.
They're going for the GG push. They're actually just going straight for the GG push. They want CDEC to admit defeat, and they get it! EG look for one game up in the TI5 Grand Final. CDEC might have had a very convincing performance in Game 2. EG hit back in a terrific display from both CDEC as well as EG. Wonderful Dota all round.
This is probably one of the best games of the tournament so far. It closes in on almost an hour. So many small plays, so many combinations, the movement patterns, the decision making.
It's just